A very good morning to one and all, and welcome. Ours is an agrarian economy with nearly 140 million land holdings, where 86% of them are small and marginal farmers, and on an average, their holding is just above 1 hectare of land. This is just a bad math. And on top of this, unfavorable weather conditions, low quality of seeds, high usage of fertilizers and pesticides, infertile land or lack of production, no or low margin incentives, loads of debt on the loans, lack of support, knowledge, always dealing with the middlemen, and the issues list goes on. I'm also sure that who and all are present here, they are aware of the current protests happening all over the country. We are today in the 60th day of the protest, and it will keep going on. Well, we are not here today to discuss the farm bills and its implications. We have already done that, and you can check that on our YouTube channel, Krishi TV. Today, we are here to acknowledge one of the major solutions for all the farmers and their issues, Farmer Producer Organization. It's a registered cooperative or a group which is formed and run by the farmers and the producers. Now, why is it needed? Its legal compliances, the opportunities that are available and the challenges that you can face and some of the best practices that one can adopt in the current changing scenario. This is what we are going to focus today. Now, before going into the session, let me take the privilege to introduce our esteemed speaker, Dr. G.V. Ramanjanelu. We call him Dr. Ramu. He did his PhD in Agricultural Extension from IARI in New Delhi. He worked there for a few years as a scientist specializing in this oil seeds. And with his determination to eradicate the usage of pesticides on the fields with the farmers, he left his well-established IARS service and started working on the field. So today, he is the executive director for Center for Sustainable Agriculture. I should say more of an agricultural scientist. And we have been working, he has been working in CSA since 2004. He focuses and the organization also focuses on working with local communities, farmer cooperatives, small help groups, self-help groups, local self-help bodies, and various partners in the states of Andhra Pradesh, Telangana, Maharashtra, Punjab, along with the governments of Chhattisgarh and Jharkhand. Working on the field level with low, marginal, and tribal farmers, providing the support and guidance through local NGOs by establishing ecological and economic sustainable models, and to organize themselves to improve their livelihoods and realize their rights. Now, without further ado, I request Dr. Ramu to join us and throw some light on this concept, which is the need of the hour. Dr. Ramu.
Thank you, Vinyasa. Thank you for that very generous introduction. Without getting into much details, let me take you directly to the topic. Today, agriculture is in crisis, so we don't need any further evidence that farming is not viable. Farming is not viable because the way we are producing, the way markets are, and the way public support is available. So all these made farming very unviable. And we are investing more to get less and less, both in terms of inputs and in terms of economy. So for every rupee spent, the returns are less than 1 rupee. And for every 1 kg of input used, the output is less than 1 kg. And for every 1 unit of energy used, the return is less than 1 unit. So that's a loss-making proposition into which current production system got into. So in that situation, a large part of the farming, if it has to become economically viable, one is we need to move towards more ecologically sustainable models of agriculture, which includes many practices which makes agriculture dependent, move away from the external dependency of what high use of chemicals, high use of water, high use of energy kind of production models. Whereas on the other hand, There is also an economic dimension to the entire agriculture-based livelihoods. Farming should become economically viable. So one, to become economically viable, how do we produce is one part of it. Second part of it is how do we sell it? And then how do we organize the entire production so that it becomes economically viable for the farmers? So that's where actually new ideas, new thoughts, new thinking was going on for a long time. And India being a country with more than half of the population depending on agriculture, for long we were discussing about cooperatives, cooperative movement. You know, India has more history of more than 100 years talking about cooperatives. And we are happy that two of the top most cooperatives in the world, recently there was a study done and top cooperatives in the world, two of the cooperatives are in India. AMUL and then IFFCO, both are in India, both are farmers cooperatives. And there are also CRIPCO, NAFED kind of things. But unfortunately, all these have not translated into economic viability of farming for the small and marginal farmers. So the gap between viability of institution and viability of farmers is also increasing significantly, even if they are farmer-producer organizations. So that's where we need to come to a kind of understanding where are the gaps and then how do we create organizations so that they become viable and their viability also contributes for the viability of the farmers. So that's a key focus of today's presentation. And this is also a kind of prologue for one of the training program which we wanted to do for building the capacities of the farmers producer organizations, farmers, and then the organizations which are working on this. So technically speaking, farmer producer organization is a legal entity. Because when individual farmers cannot deal with an issue, how the primary producers can come together and deal with their livelihood. So to deal with that, creating a legal entity is what we are calling as a farmer producer organization. It can be registered as a producer company. There's a new act under producer in the Companies Act. It can be registered as a producer company. It can be registered as a cooperative or any other legal form. It can be in any legal form. And essentially, it's a legal entity. And there are minor variances in terms of legal requirements. If it is registered under a cooperative act or it is registered under a producer company. But anything is fine as long as we are comfortable with that. Depending on the size of the operations, depending on the issues involved, depending on the range of the issues you want to deal with, depending on the scale of operations, we can decide which model of registration we can go for. For example, in a private limited company model or a public limited company or a partnership, if you look at there are different ways of doing business. Similarly, for farmers, it could be cooperative or a producer company. So cooperative registrations, the registering under cooperatives is viable if it is a small group where people know each other face to face and it can be run by the farmers themselves. So cooperative is an easy model to do because the legal compliances are far lower. On the flip side, getting access to credit, getting access to support, getting access to partnerships with other organizations for business could be a bit more difficult because cooperative runs more informally. And since the legal compliances are little, credibility is a bit lower. And it can be established over a period of time by our own operations, but that's a reality of it. Whereas a producer company, since it follows the exactly like the Companies Act, the advantage is that you can actually get access to credit, get access to our partnerships, and get access to other grants and support easily. So that's a choice one need to make. But the legal compliances are higher, which means your expenses as well as the burden of management are higher in producer companies. And it can also be primary producers. It could be a federations. So we can also register, do this in different forms as well. And in India, there are several key promoting organizations. NABARD is one of the major organization, and SFAC, Small Farmers Agribusiness Consortium, NCDC, National Cooperative Development Corporation, NAFED, which is National Agriculture Cooperative Marketing Federation of India, NRLM, National Rural Livelihoods Mission, Department of Agriculture, Department of Horticulture, Department of Animal Husbandry, and various other line departments. So all are the key supporting organizations. Of course, many NGOs across the country are also involved in the promoting and supporting this kind of farmer producer organizations. Today, if you see where we actually stand, as of 2019 March 31st, there are 7,374 farmer producer organizations registered as producer companies, which has nearly about 4.3 million shareholders. And most of them are small and marginal farmers. But in this, only about 6,926 are active. And Maharashtra alone accounts for about 25% of the total producer companies in India. And Maharashtra, Uttar Pradesh, Tamil Nadu, and Madhya Pradesh, these four states together accounts for about 50% of the producer companies registered. And this shows how skewed is the distribution. Second important issue is all these organizations, all the farmer producer organizations which are existing today, put together have a paid up capital of about 860 crores. But the catch is in these 860 crores, just 100 companies has about 587 crores. And the rest of the two thirds of the total paid up capital comes from just 189 companies. And there are there are 189 companies with just less than 1,000 rupees paid up capital kind of thing. So this entire thing is a highly distorted situation. So you have many are registered and producer organization, but their share capital and paid up capital is far lower. I think that's a key challenge in most of the organizations. And 86% of the total active producer companies are very small with less than 10 lakhs paid up capital, and only 2.6% of active companies have more than 25 lakhs. So it's just 2.6% of it. So while this shows that there is a possibility of growth, the possibility of establishing, the challenge lies in terms of how you actually build an institution. And apart from this, there are mutually aided cooperatives, primary agriculture credit cooperatives, multi-state cooperatives, and various other forms of institutions. I only talked about the producer companies since they began in 2002. So from 2002 to 2000, so it's nearly about 8 to 9 years of time period. In this period, these are the farmer producer organizations which have come up, and this is a reality in front of us. Why we are like this? If we look at from that, key challenge is about mobilizing people and then mobilizing the finances. These two seems to be the most critical. Why it happens? If you look at from that point of view, key issues comes up as the farmers today being in crisis, they're unable to manage 1-2 acres of land. So 1-2 acres of land is also a business enterprise. And 1-2 acres of land as an enterprise, when they are unable to manage, we're expecting them to come together, form an institution, and then put in investment and then build a business, which is far from reality. So it needs a lot of effort to mobilize farmers, mobilize finances, and build their capacities so that they can handle all this. So these three processes of mobilization, building their capacities, and then building the business which is viable in that particular situation takes time to mature. And without focusing on that, we are madly going in terms of a target number targets. So I think that's a key challenge we need to look at. So human resource capacity is a key challenge. So how people can come together, how people can manage themselves, how people can make a plan, and then how people can handle the business. So all these requires a lot of capacity building, a lot of planning, and then a lot of support. So these things are missing in this whole initiative. Second issue is people coming together may happen, but it takes time to mature. So what is your plan in terms of how you evolve is an important issue. Many times we expect them to run the day one, and the day one, the institution may not be viable. Today, look at any company in this world or in India, many of the even private limited companies, they have a life of its of their own. So they initially slowly start and then grow, and then that's where they get stabilized. So that time, that kind of time to mature and then stabilize is something which is very, very important. Look at the women's self-help group movement in this country. It took nearly 20, 25 years to stabilize. So that kind of time need to be given to mature. I think that's a key thing which is available. And to make it happen, it also requires a lot of support. But today, the support available for farmer producer organizations to farm and then to manage is very, very little. So with that kind of support, which is available from the governments, it is becoming extremely difficult to manage these FPOs. So access to credit is always a serious problem, because till now, we have not come up with the financial products which are useful and helpful for the farmers organization. So we need to work towards that. Also, in India, typically departments have a bureaucratic approach, and they work in top-down silos. So Department of Agriculture has certain some FPOs, women's self-help groups run through, NRLM has some FPOs, Horticulture Department will have FPOs, NABARD will have FPOs, and all of them overlap on each other. And they all try to drag the same farmer who is active in the village. So the few farmers who are active will be members of all FPOs, and many will not be covered by any of them. So that's a kind of situation in which we are. So the duplication of efforts is a serious issue. So how we can build a kind of convergence so that this duplication can be avoided is one of the important issue which we need to look for. And any organization in this country or the world, if you look at, they can only run if viable support services are available. Any institution cannot do everything. So we need to figure out what can be internalized into the institution and what support we take from an external source, because specialization is also required for certain activities. So for the in that situation, figuring out what an FPO can do and what support services it can take from outside has become a big issue. And typically what is happening is we expect everything to be done by an FPO and supported by one staff member, and that one staff member paid very meager salary. We are expecting that they will do all the wonders which an FPO is expected to do. I think that's where the problem lies. So we need to look at how that can be addressed. And by law, to be a member of farmer producer organization, you need to have a certificate that you are a farmer. And in this country, since there is no mechanism of identifying who is a farmer, land patta becomes the major identity to become a farmer. So joining as a members is still a difficulty in many states. In some states, we could get through Department of Agriculture giving a certificate saying the concerned person is a farmer, but in many cases that is also not accepted. So it is becoming a difficulty. So how tenant farmers also can become members of the producer organizations is something which is very, very critical. And many times in India, we have tenant farmers, agricultural workers, small farmers, agricultural labor put together in the same family. So a person can be partly doing farming, partly doing labor. So in that kind of situations, getting this access is becoming very, very difficult. So how we address this is also a policy challenge which we have. We need to look for. And how we try to address, and then what are the viable mechanisms if we look at, what we try to do is following the same the SHG, successful SHG model of community building, a federation of groups, community institutions is the best model rather than having one big institution. So if you are talking about a farmers cooperative of 500 people or a farmer producer company with nearly 1,000 people or 2,000 farmers kind of thing, if entire institution has direct primary membership, if all farmers becomes members of the cooperative directly, it becomes extremely difficult in terms of management. Extremely difficult because always the voice of small is ignored. So what we tried to do is to organize farmers into smaller groups. So 10 to 15 farmers being in a smaller group. They could be small and marginal farmers who live in a vicinity or who grow a particular crop or take a particular livelihood activity. Or it could be single woman in a village, other vulnerable groups in the village. So like that, we tried to pick up small groups. So 10 to 15 farmers, 10 to 15 producers are the smallest group. That's what we try to do. And that seems to be a better option. And then these groups can be your livelihood groups, or it could be part of your, if you are into organic production or into any kind of certification for your production, it could be organic, it could be good agriculture practices, any kind of certification system if you want to follow also, this group can become the basic unit on which you can build on. So our suggestion would be in terms of go for smaller groups and all planning, all traceability, all your work can focus on that group. So a group can make their business plan, and your producer organization's business plan is typically an amalgamation of all groups. So when you are making a plan at the production level, when you are making a plan for procurement, when you make a plan for any processing, do it at a group level. That's the best option. And then the producer organization will be serving all these FPOs, all these members groups. So livelihood portfolio can be crop production, livestock, inputs, value addition, or non-farm activities. But all these we need to figure out when we are working with small and marginal farmers. We expect that a farmer doing four or five, the more diversified sources of income, farmer's income will be increasing. But at the same time, we also need to see what is the time availability and the skill which farmer can acquire. So the more livelihood activities farmers get into, difficulty would be in terms of building knowledge and skill in that particular activity. So if I take up four or five different activities, I cannot become specialized in all these. So I'll be master of none. I'll be jack of all trades and master of none kind of thing. So that's typically what is happening with the farmers. We need to figure out what one or two activities, livelihood activities will be viable for the particular farmer. We need to have a mechanism of identifying that and then building the capacities of the farmers, making a plan for that. So I think that's a key challenge. So if the same farmer does poultry, if the same farmer does the sheep and goat, if the same farmer does vegetable production, same farmer does cotton, grain production. So all these things is extremely difficult. I think that is something we need to figure out as an organization to first who does what kind of thing. So this is the first exercise any farmer producer organization has to do. And based on that, can we look at what is the plan in terms of strengthening existing production system before thinking of getting into a new production systems? What is the plan for strengthening the existing production system? Say farmers are already doing vegetables. So how do we strengthen vegetable production? If farmers are already doing having a livestock, how do we improvise that livestock? If farmers are doing seed production, how do we improvise seeds? So I think that's the kind of planning initially we need to do. Then look at what are the one or two additional livelihood opportunities we can create in the village based on the resources available and the opportunities available. That is the second exercise we can look at. And to make it happen, what are the forward linkages and backward linkages which are required? So that's a plan of action which one need to look into when we are building a farmer producer organization.